Call this meeting to order. Adequate notice of this meeting has been provided by posting on the bulletin board in Village Hall, by mail to the Ridgewood News, the Record, and by submission to all persons entitled to the same as provided by law of a schedule, including the date and time of this meeting. Roll call, please.
Councilwoman Houck.
Here.
Councilman Puccirelli.
Here.
Councilman Ritchie.
Here.
Councilwoman Walsh.
Here.
And Mayor Aronson.
Here. Please join us as we salute the flag.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please join us now for a moment of silence as we honor the American men and women serving in armed forces, as well as those serving as first responders. Thank you. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our meeting this evening. We're going to take care of a couple of quick administrative things, and then we have something very exciting to do. We're going to be swearing in our new police officer. I move that bills, claims, and vouchers and statement of funds on hand as of September 30th, 2013 be accepted as submitted.
Second.
Houck.
Yes.
Puccirelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. I move that Village Council minutes of September 11th and September 18th, 2013, having been reviewed by the Village Council and now available in the Village Clerk's office, be approved as submitted.
Second.
Houck.
Yes.
Puccirelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes, we have no proclamations this night, but we're going to go down there and we're going to swear in our newest police officer, Christopher Marmina. I, Christopher Marmina, do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of New Jersey, and that I will faithfully, impartially, and justly perform all of the duties of the office of police officer according to the best of my ability. So help me God. Congratulations. You guys can stay if you want. It always gets a laugh. All right, we'll move to comments from the public. Please, anybody who has a question, comment, suggestion, thought, words of praise, please step to the podium.
Hi.
Good evening.
Hi.
Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes.
I'll try. Ellie Gruber, 229 South Irving. First of all, I just have to say it's colder here than in the dairy department of the Stop and Shop. Why is it so freezing here?
Trying to save money.
There, huh? No. Oh, never mind. Anyway, there's no way to make it just normal here. Look, everyone's dressed like the middle of the winter. It's just cold. It seems like waste. But anyway, that's not why I'm here. Every year, Wildscape gives a report on our cleanup from every year. So this year is 2013. First of all, we couldn't do this without the sanction of the Village Council, so we thank you. Chris Rudeshauser is our mainstay. He arranges for all the equipment, the gloves, the rakes, the bags, and the most important, to make sure the sanitation department picks up all the debris from the area. There were 40 volunteers during a drizzling rain, adults and children from the Ridgewood Wildscape Association, REAC, AM Rotary, Unitarian Society, and Temple Israel. Ed Schwartz was the mainstay during the cleanup. His positive outlook and faith that six middle-aged men could lift a 250-pound bridge out of the pond and up a steep hill was key. Our hall, in addition to this prize, the bridge, and we're going to post a picture on our website shortly, in under 2 hours from Gypsy Pond, we got 26 contractor-sized bags full of trash, too degraded to recycle, 8 tires, 1 large traffic cone, gigantic tarp, sleeping bags, PVC metal piping, chairs, wood, propane tank, fire extinguisher, and dozens of balls, golf, baseball, and soccer included. This is our third time at Gypsy, and removing all this debris removes impediments to the flow of the water. We still have gigantic logs that floated down during Hurricane Sandy, and hopefully sometime in the near future they can be removed. But I really thank you for your support the council's given over the years. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for all your good work, Ellie. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Hi. Well, Patty Infantino, 6 Betty Court. Hi, councilmen and women and distinguished mayor. I'm here because we're all upset on my part of town about the conceptual rendering of the Shedler property. It flies in the face of all the 200 at least letters that we sent you about what we feel like. People who live near Route 17, that tremendous amount of highway and the tremendous amount of pollution we get, which of course you have nothing to do with, but if you cut down our trees, which we will be discussing tonight, 4 acres of trees to make something like this, we're going to get a lot more pollution and everything else and noise. What we really are upset about is that we talk so much with you about the fact of making it equitable to Habernacle. And this 990 degree field that was the field that came off of BF, and then you're looking for a spot to get, you're putting it in a part of town where you don't think that we're going to respond to it. Just because we don't have a school and we don't have the same communication systems that other people have available to them in Ridgewood, we can react to this, and we are horrified. I'm horrified by the turnaround. I actually went to see if I could speak to the fire department to see, what would you do? Can you get to my house on time with this turnaround? I mean, this is not just a bump in the road. This can the fire trucks get to my house if you do this to the street? And it's not just me. I'm speaking for the people in my part of town. We feel that you just haven't listened to us. We've sent you letters and everything else, and it's like we're chopped liver. I'm really upset about it.
Sure. I appreciate your comments. If I could, you said we're going to speak about it tonight.
Parts of historic preservation.
You mentioned the tree policy.
And I'm saying there's a lot of trees on this particular land, and that if this were to actually be taken up by the town, this particular 90-foot field, you'd be cutting down 4 acres of trees.
Sure. All I was saying is that's not on our agenda for this evening.
Oh. I pointed it out because I didn't know where this came from. I don't know who authorized and pays for this schematic, but it's totally in the face
of
everyone.
I haven't missed any meetings, and you gave the impression that somehow that has been approved, and it hasn't been approved. I think it's still up for discussion, very much so. I think there may be the wrong impression because it's on a website, but
also,
that's the plan.
The other thing is that we're trying to save the house. We have the Ridgewood Historical Society. They're going to build a library there. It's not going to cost the town money. We're working feverishly on this, and this is like the house isn't even here. The field is 12 times bigger than we ever expected. I mean, it's just really disturbing.
If I could, again, we certainly appreciate your comments. There might have been a miscommunication. We're not addressing the Shedler issue tonight. The last time we addressed it was when the Open Space Committee last year, presented their recommendations to us. We haven't taken it up. There have been a lot of different conversations, as you know, with some of your neighbors, but we haven't moved forward with anything at this point.
Okay. So I guess wanted to give you feedback to this thing that I just discovered.
Where does that appear? Where did you find it?
Yeah, I think this is Chris Chris, our town engineer, put this together. I don't know who ordered it. I mean, and this dimensions and everything else. I mean, it's mind-boggling to me that who ordered this and why this, you know, I mean, we're paying for it because our town engineer built it. His name is on it.
Yeah, so again, we haven't, and I don't know exactly what you have in your hand. We haven't moved beyond the recommendations that we got from the Open Space Committee. Again, there have been a lot of discussions, some of them trying to address some of the concerns. There have been a lot of visits to the Shedler House. But beyond that, we haven't really moved forward in any formal way. So what you might be holding there might be some notional drawing, and I don't know, but nothing concrete has happened. We haven't moved forward on this issue yet.
Okay, we'd just like to put in our hair-raising response to this, okay?
Yeah, no, thank you. We do appreciate it. Thank you. Good evening. Welcome.
My name is Susan Donnelly, and I'm here representing the Community Relations Advisory Board, 115 Pine Street. I'm actually here in the stead of Reverend Jan Phillips, who is our chair, who was unfortunately detained in Europe, so she couldn't be here. I'm here to invite you to one of our very exciting meetings that we have once a month in the Garden Room. Because our acronym is very unfortunate, CRAB, we make sure our meetings are lively and focused and to the point. But we usually meet at 7:30, but on the 23rd of this month, we plan to meet at 7, hoping that some of you may join us and we can excite you about what we are doing as excited as we are. CRAB has been around for about 25 years. It was established after an incident of bias here in town, and we respond to any bias incidents that come our way, and we try to set an atmosphere of anti-bias and bullying for Ridgewood. We have posters made up, which we hope to place in businesses in town that say it has a group of clasped hands in a circle of different colors, and it says respect. Did you have a question? I'm sorry. No, okay. that's probably all I have, but we hope to see you on the 23rd at 7 in the Garden Room. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you. Thanks for the invitation. Thanks for your great work. And I told Jan, I'm planning to be there, and hopefully some of us can be there.
Thanks.
We appreciate you moving your time also to allow for us to
be there. Thanks so much. And I left a couple of brochures here if anyone's interested.
Great, thank you. Thanks. Good evening. Welcome.
Good evening. My name is Michelle Italia DeLugash. I'm wearing red because I represent the red group. In reference to proposed letter, that this letter is to the council members, and I have been asked to read it to you in reference to what our feelings are in the Shedler property. So I'm going to read this letter because it represents their thoughts. We, the families in the close proximity to the Shedler property, are writing to express a strong and unequivocal disapproval of the proposed development by the Open Space Committee that has been put forth to the Village Council on October 24, 2012. We have studied the conceptual proposed detail and, based on the review, have deemed it to be completely unacceptable as to the health, safety, and the quality of life concerns of the local residents and completely ignored. We strongly believe that the current proposal to remove the majority of the trees in order to build an overlarge 340 baseball multipurpose field and the extensive 74 parking space lot will significantly endanger the day-to-day health, welfare, and the quality of life many longtime resident adults and their children in the area. It is important to note that the safety and health impacts of the Shedler is significantly greater and much more serious than considered during the development of the Habernacle Family Park. Why? Simply put, the trees removed from this property, the Habernacle property, to the local location of the heights of the area. And if you compare that with Route 17, never served as a sound barrier the way that they do for us. It is proposed, if the proposed is put through, the thick tree buffer along 17 is eliminated and replaced with a 350-foot base-walled multi-purpose field. Subsequently, the Village Council will be directly endangering the welfare and the local residents of members of the area. Noise level. The current tree barrier and noise level from Route 17 would rise to 65 decibels. Pollution. The pollution level from Route 17. The current tree barrier helps create a natural, efficient, and filtered wall against the carbon monoxide and the car exhaust. Removing the trees would increase the level of toxic air, posing to the long-term health of the local welfare of the families would be at risk. This could not be rectified by erecting a man-made barrier in that area. Traffic safety. The narrow local country road simply cannot take the increased traffic. It is even narrower than Hillcrest, which is at the Habernacle location. The current conceptual plan shows a design that the parking lot entrance from West Saddle River Road. This design will not only increase traffic neighborhood traffic patterns, but also create a higher traffic accident risk. There is not enough ramp left on West Saddle River Road exit to safely slow down and to make the complete stop to, at proposed entrance of the parking lot. Likely to increase crime is also a factor because it is such an accessible way of Route 17, and we do have our issues with problems of crime in that area because it's so accessible to 17. By designing that and removing the trees, you're only creating more people coming into the area, transient people coming into the area, making it easier to get quickly in and out of that area. So that is a health concern as far as we're concerned in that area of Ridgewood. In short, despite the fair and balanced rhetoric, the current conceptual proposed from the Open Space Committee neither fair to the local resident regarding their justified concern about the impact of the neighborhood quality of life, nor does it propose a balanced plan in terms of the usage of the actual space. The plan represented by the council on October 24th is actually less balanced than proposed one in July 10th of 1997. The Open Space Committee promised to propose an active passive park. Instead, they are proposed a large playing field and a parking lot. It is important to note that the residents in the neighborhood directly impacted by the development of the Shedler property feel that the Open Space Committee did not appropriately reflect the decision held and concerns raised in three-hour public meetings. Time and again, the Open Space Committee assured the residents that their concerns should be fully addressed and presented on October 24th. In reality, however, the Open Space Committee failed to create a plan that addressed the issues brought to the local by the local members. We remind the Village Council that your primary responsibility, above all concern, is in to ensure the health and safety and quality of life for the Ridgewood resident. Regardless of the neighborhood location and their special interest group, as such, in this issue alone, it is your duty to reject the open space proposal. We therefore urge the Village Council to conserve the trees, preserve the quality of life of the Ridgewood resident. To accomplish this goal, we request the following. The current field development proposal must be completely voided, and a new vision for the truly multi-purpose area park be created for the Shedler property as it was for the Habernacle property. It would entail creating a task force entrusted with putting together a long-term vision for the Shedler family park that should share the same success the village has achieved in the other park. The vision should include plans for retaining the house and preserving the majority of the trees on the property, especially the thick natural barrier that the trees create along Route 17. We steadfastly oppose any plan that includes a 350-foot baseball multipurpose field, but in ensuring that the needs of the local organized sports group are met, we would welcome a smaller multipurpose field that minimizes the tree removal and allocated a greater percentage of the land to the green space. Local neighborhood residents representatives on the board that the task is determining, planning, and implementing a vision for the Shedler Park that would be local resident would be directly impacted any development on the Shedler Family Park on a 24/7 basis. It is imperative that this committee must include strong representation from the Shedler neighborhood. No artificial or accelerated framework should be created in implementing the Shedler development plan. The plan for the Habernacle took 8 years. The Shedler neighborhood residents were told that the development must proceed within the next year, specifically to save the Shedler house. We have been given 6 to 12 months to find a use. Again, by contrast, no ultimatum was placed on the house located on the Habernacle property.
Excuse me, I'm sorry, I hate to interrupt. We usually have 3 minutes and we've obviously gone long over there.
I will end this by simply saying that the agreement utilizes the town funds, but yet in the Habernacle property, it has always been the town funds. But yet you have asked us that we should raise private money so that we could save the house. Where is the equality in this process?
Thank you. Thank you very much for your comments. And if you want to leave a copy of that letter with us,
if you'd like to,
sure. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. I'll make copies for you. Okay. Great. Thank you.
Ziggy Puttins, 572 Fairway Road, Ridgewood, New Jersey. Thank you for your time listening to this. I've been attending the recent hospital meetings before the planning board, as well as having attended the meetings back in 2008 and 2010. It's my experience at the planning board meetings that discuss the H-zone amendments to the master plan, the ones that are defining the changes to the master plan, are very one-sided. Now, every side has two sides. Every story has two sides. The applicant clearly presents their side, but I have to ask, where is the other side in these proceedings? In my view, from the previous and current H-zone amended meetings, the question being raised is not what if or should we, but how would we? There's no discussion or debate on what if or should we part. The tone and testimony of the applicant's witnesses, funded by the applicant, never goes into the question, let's see if this is a good idea, or what are the downsides of the applicant's approach? And I would not expect them to ask that question. But I don't see the issues of the other side presented from the planning board. I don't see it from the planning board's experts. I didn't know until the last meeting that the planning board had its own hospital planner. I understand he has been at the meetings, but I don't know what he or the other town-funded experts contribute to the proceedings. In the 2008-2010 proceedings, I don't recall them offering any testimony, and their participation seemed to be limited only to asking questions. I don't know what their participation will be in the current proceedings, but I hope it won't be a repeat of their limited contribution. But there is a very vocal group who do have contrarian views who do want to ask, should we? I'm referring to the residents. But their input is very, very limited. They're always told to limit yourself to 3 questions, and if you have more, go to the back of the line. When it comes to public input, that time is limited to 3 minutes. To me, there's the pro forma activity. There is an organized group, the CRR, that has some backing in both people and money, but the funding for them is mostly from the people in the affected areas, not from large businesses or from the town. I'm getting to my point here. At the last planning board meeting, the CRR's expert said he had an alternative to the proposed H-zone amendment. The applicant's attorney said he can't discuss it until CRR pays all the application fees as prescribed by the village's ordinance. The chair did not entertain the altered amendment. At that point, it struck me, if you want to present an alternative amendment, you have to pay the fees, thousands of dollars. Or if you want substantial face time to present alternative testimony that represents the views of your neighbors, you have to produce, in the words of the Planning Board's counsel, a certificate of incorporation. You have to form a company. Getting serious debate on the should-be has a very high threshold. So what's my point? I'm asking the council to examine how this pay-to-present a master zone amendment ordinance see how it's played out over the last 6 years since its adoption. I personally don't think it's worked out very well.
Thank you very much, Zeke. Appreciate it. Any other questions or comments?
I couldn't understand.
All right. Going to the manager's report there.
Yes, this past Sunday, the PBA and FMBA, our finest and bravest, played a softball game for charity. Our recreation staff assisted the fire and police departments in organizing the event. Through their efforts, they raised approximately $4,000, and I want to thank all the participants. Next Wednesday, October 16th, is a general election to fill Senator Frank Lautenberg's unexpired term. The polls will be open from 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. in the usual polling locations. If you wish to vote early by mail, you can do so at the county clerk's office. They're open between 9 and 4 tomorrow and Friday. They're open 9 to 1 on Saturday, and then they're also open 9 to 3 on Tuesday. That's the last time you can vote in person vote by mail, mail-in ballot. Also, October 14th, this coming Monday, is Columbus Day, and Village Hall and all the offices in Village Hall as well as the stable are closed, and there's no garbage or recycling pickup on that day.
Great. Thanks, Heather. And move on to Village Council reports. Bernie?
We had our REAC meeting this week. You know, we had talked about the trees. It was not on the agenda tonight. I'm sorry. Maybe there was a mix-up that somebody thought that we had it on the agenda tonight. So we're waiting, as I mentioned, for Blaze to make some corrections so I can bring it back to the council. We had discussed our rocket composter again and working with the Board of Ed in terms of where and how we could make that part of our community. We talked a lot about education of the kids in terms of, you know, once you start teaching them, then they can kind of teach the parents a little bit and move forward with that. We're going to be applying for some grants over the next few months, and everything's positive there. That's it.
Great. Thanks, Bernie. Albert?
Thank you. Tonight we will be considering a resolution to authorize the feasibility study for the garage location, possible location, to be shared with Glen Rock. And Glen Rock is doing the same thing tonight. At the last meeting, we discussed that it was only tasks 1 and 2 that were under consideration, which come to $5,200, not the entire $60,000 proposal that was made to us from this vendor. Glen Rock didn't appreciate that. They didn't understand it, so they tabled it until tonight, and they too will be voting on the same form of resolution as we're voting on this evening to share that $5,200 cost. Second, the Historic Preservation Commission will meet on Thursday, tomorrow evening, and they have added to their agenda the barn at Habernickle Park, which, as you'll recall, was the subject of some discussion before this council as to whether we should expend money to determine whether the barn is structurally sound for purposes of installing new lavatory facilities, among other facilities. So I went as the liaison to the Historic Preservation Commission and asked that they tell this council whether there is any historic significance and that they add their view also as to the aesthetic worth of the barn so that will be factored into the decision. That's tomorrow evening at their meeting at 7:30 in the garden room.
Thanks, Albert.
Tom?
I have nothing new.
I guess I should talk about Novel Night from the Ridgewood Library. They had a fundraiser on Saturday night. You know, the 20 homes cooked dinners in their homes, and each home had anywhere from 10 to 45 people eat there from 7:30 to 9, and then at 9 o'clock you go over to the library for dancing and dessert with Dad's Night Band playing, and we had a total of 400 people packed into the library, so it was lively and a real great social event and a different way for the library to bring the community together. They raised at least $45,000. They're still, you know, cashing the checks, but it was a big success and a lot of fun. Yeah. Tomorrow for the Community Center Advisory Board, we are doing another Let's Stay Acquainted luncheon for the seniors, and we're also bringing the Access community on board because we're doing Gold Star Sheriff's IDs afterwards, where Sheriff, is it Saudino?
Saudino.
Sheriff Saudino is actually coming to Village Hall with some of his aides to issue ID cards to seniors and teenagers with disabilities. And all you have to do is have your social security number and fill out this form, which is on the Village website. And they will give you an ID card, which if you have a memory lapse or a medical emergency, first responders can call the can link up with the county and figure out who you are, what any of your special needs are. And that's especially important for, say, seniors with dementia or special needs individuals who sometimes look like their issues are kind of not easily identifiable, so an ID like that is helpful. Then also my seniors group is having a forum in November, which is, it's a major effort that we're trying to put forth to create more visibility for the senior center down in the basement of Village Hall. We're co-sponsoring with Bergen Community College, the Ridgewood Community Center, and the Volunteer Center of Bergen County, the Ridgewood YMCA, Christian Healthcare Center, the Hobbyists, HILT Group, Children's Aid Family Services, the Ridgewood Library, the Bergen County Division of Senior Services, Valley Hospital, West Bergen Mental Health Care, and the Bergen County Division of Community Development. We have a panel of five members who are going to discuss how do senior citizens in suburbia foster a positive view of aging by contributing their time and skills to improve our communities. So it's kind of a different spin on how is it, what's it like to be a senior in our community? Do we need services, or can we actually give back to the community? And if we give back, how can seniors give back? So there'll be about 12 different tables in the wings of the Campus Center at Ridgewood High School, where the forum is on November 7th, with the different clubs and organizations that provide either support or socialization activities, clubs you can join if you are a senior. So I encourage everyone to come if you're 60 or older, or if you're a caregiver for somebody who's a senior. It's going to be a great day, and I'm really proud of this community for what we're putting forth on November 7th at the Campus Center from 12 to 2.
Great, thank you. Sounds like a great program. And just with respect to tomorrow's initiative with the Sheriff's Office, this should be also a great program. As Gwen said, very important that seniors and teenagers with disabilities have identification cards. I think we have a lot of seniors and families already signed up, ready to go tomorrow. So
yeah,
it should be a really good event. I encourage everybody to come. Related to that, next week we have our Access Ridgewood annual Disability Awareness Weekend, October 18th to the 20th. We have one of our posters over there. We've got so many events, something going on in all the schools. The clergy are involved. We got performances. We have a special needs soccer game. It should be a really great weekend, and I encourage you, if you can come to one or more events, please do so. The Chamber had their monthly meeting today. Everybody's very pleased with the results of the fashion show from a couple weeks ago, as well as with the golf outing. They raised a lot of money and had a good time. It was able to reach out to, I think, increased number of businesses. I think the Chamber number, in terms of the amount of businesses they have now as members, is over 300, which is pretty phenomenal. Lastly, Planning Board, the big news is we didn't have a meeting this week, so that's the good news. We are meeting next week to talk about multifamily housing, and then the week after, I believe on the 22nd, we'll be revisiting the Valley issue. And that's it with my Village Council report. Now we'll move on to ordinances, introduction of a couple of ordinances. We'll start with 3395. I move for the first reading of ordinance 3395.
Second.
Houck.
Yes.
Cucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. So ordered. Will the clerk please read ordinance 3395 by title?
An ordinance to amend Chapter 265 of the Code of the Village of Ridgewood, Vehicles and Traffic, at Section 265-59, Schedule 9, Stop Intersections.
I move that ordinance 3395 be adopted on our first reading and that November 13, 2013 be fixed as the date for the hearing thereon.
Second.
Houck.
Yes.
Cucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. I move the first reading into ordinance 3396.
I second.
Houck.
Yes.
Cucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. So ordered. Will the clerk please read ordinance 3396 by title?
An ordinance to amend Chapter 265 of the Code of the Village of Ridgewood, Vehicles and Traffic, at Section 265-59, Schedule 9, Stop Intersections.
I move that ordinance 3396 be adopted on first reading and that November 13, 2013 be fixed as the day for the hearing thereon.
I second.
Houck.
Yes.
Cucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. Can we move on to our public hearings? I move the clerk read ordinance 3391 by title and second reading and that the public hearing thereon be opened.
Second.
Houck.
Yes.
Cucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. Will the clerk please read the title of ordinance 3391?
An ordinance of the Village of Ridgewood in the County of Bergen, New Jersey, appropriating $41,580 for rehabilitation of the turf field at Maple Park.
The public hearing is now open. I'm sorry.
Second.
I move that ordinance 339.
No, we have to. The public hearing is open.
Oh, the public hearing is open.
No takers. Okay, now we'll move the public hearing be closed.
Second.
I move. Okay. Yes.
Cucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yep.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes.
Now, I move that ordinance 3391 be adopted on second reading and final publication as required by law.
I second the motion.
Houck.
Yes.
Cucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. I move the clerk read ordinance 3392 by title on second reading and that the public hearing thereon be opened.
Second.
Houck.
Yes.
Cucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. Will the clerk please read the title of ordinance 3392?
A bond ordinance providing for various capital improvements in and by the Village of Ridgewood in the County of Bergen, New Jersey, appropriating $3,328,763, therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $2,800,000 bonds or notes of the village to finance part of the cost thereof.
Public hearing is now open. Good evening.
Evening, Mayor and Council. Roger Wygand, 216 South Irving Street. I have a few comments, a couple of questions about this ordinance and some of the items in it. As you know, it is a lot of money, so I tend to pay attention to when there's a couple of commas in a number. So if we could just, I'm just going to make some comments in the order that this information is in the ordinance. First of all, I look back at an ordinance that was passed in December of last year, and it appears that a number of items that are in this ordinance were bonded for in that ordinance as well. And I don't know why that is, except that I guess the projects that were bonded for there were not completed or they were not started, and this is additional money needed. I don't think it's a good idea to do that. I am a person in favor of having each department head come to the council at a public meeting, present what they need, and then you vote on it up or down and then bond for it. And this would not happen if that were the case. And I'll point out a couple of items in the first, under the police department. There's an item on body armor, and on 12-5, when the last ordinance was passed, there was $143,000 for body armor, amongst other items, and we don't know what the breakdown is there, and that included a state grant, and now I see we're going for another $116,000, and part of that's going to be for body armor. Now, I don't know whether they didn't buy it all or it was never purchased. Don't know.
Yeah, it's rotating. They do parts of the body armor, and so it's phased.
So they don't buy it all at once?
Correct.
Okay. Is there a reason for that?
Cost, probably, you know, to just move forward. Also, $116,000 that you're referencing also includes police trucks.
Yes, no, I understand.
It's not just body armor.
Yeah, no, I realize that, yes. Okay. I'm really pointing out that it seems like these things keep reoccurring. Now, this is not the only one. I'm just starting at the beginning here and going through. Now, the other, on that first page there, the lightning detection equipment. I understand that the company is out of business. I think you folks discussed that at one of the meetings. So now are we going to buy another system? I mean, what's happening here? Because that's looks like $52,000 approximately for another system. And I don't know who we're buying this from, but my understanding is that parts are not available for the existing system. Is that correct?
Yes, the new system is being looked into.
Okay.
That's correct.
Hopefully it'll be a company that stays in business for a while. I was not in favor of this, as you know, probably, when it was originally proposed. I'm the old school, when you hear the thunder, get off the field. So I don't know. We've progressed, maybe. I don't know. Moving to the next page, this is the thing I was talking about before. We bonded $25,000 in about 10 months ago in December for an ambulance, ambulance 12, and now we're going another $84,000. So
It's like a savings account. It's like a sinking fund. We put money into it. I believe this is the last amount of money so that we will be able to purchase the ambulance.
I mean, I'm not against buying an ambulance. I'm just wondering that. So in other words, what you're saying is that we don't borrow all the money necessary for the purchase at the time that we originally bond.
Right. We don't borrow. It's like a line of credit. We don't borrow it until we need it.
Multi-year funding.
Correct. It's like a savings account. You know, if you have to save up for something that's expensive, you're going to put a little away each month or each year or however you do it. It's the same thing. Here we're putting away money each year to be able to afford an expensive ambulance. And as I said, I believe, and maybe Ms. Fanzeri can give me a yes or a no, but I think this was the last payment for that ambulance, correct? So therefore, now we have enough money to purchase the ambulance with this final appropriation.
But I fail to see, thank you for that explanation.
Okay.
But I don't understand what the savings are by doing it that way. Why not just bond for the whole, whatever it might be, doesn't have to be the ambulance, could be anything else, at the time that the department head requests the item?
Because then it allows other departments to request capital items as well. It would prohibit other departments from getting in their capital requests if we budgeted an ambulance all at once. Or a fire truck, any big piece of equipment.
Okay. I have a couple of other questions also on this page. Thank you, Heather, for that explanation. Down under parks, I see they want to acquire a log hauling truck. Now, presumably, that's according to the number here, it's over $300,000. Now, that, I assume, represents the full price of the truck. So we're not going to set up a savings fund for that. We're going to buy that one shot. Now, first of all, could someone explain? I'm not quite sure what that is. And, is there any other options that we have here besides buying our own piece of equipment?
I don't know that there are other options. I believe it's replacing a piece of machinery that we had already. I don't know. Mr. Sanzeri, do you recall? Could you come up to the microphone, please? You could just sit up here. That's fine. And just turn on the mic. Thanks.
passes.
Thank you.
Okay. The purchase of the log hauling truck is a vehicle that Parks Department has had, and it's well beyond its useful life. It also has a crane attachment for it to move heavy logs and haul them away for the tree department.
So this is for when a removal is done, the main trunk of the tree is
That's correct.
Put on the truck. Now, my question, would it be feasible to subcontract this out to a private company to pick up the logs when they're, in other words, the trunk of the tree, as opposed to owning our own equipment?
I'm just here to do the funding of that operation. The department head would have to answer that question.
Okay. Yeah, I just think that maybe should be explored because, again, this is the useful life of this truck is listed as 5 years. So you wonder whether or not we could have something a little different on that basis.
Right, and because of the fact, if this capital ordinance is approved this evening, this just allows this appropriation to be made. However, the actual bid has to come back to the council for approval. If they would prefer that we go out and see how much a subcontractor would be, we could certainly do that. So,
I'm just suggesting that I don't know whether it's...
And Mr. Rodersauser also had a comment.
Regarding your suggestion that we contract out, that could be problematic, particularly if we do removal, because we'd have to leave a stalk or a large logs on the side of the road until such time we had a vendor to pick them up. It could be days, it could be weeks. During leaf season, they'd interfere with leaf collection. And in winter, if they were covered by snow, they'd be a significant hazard to our snowplow crews. We prefer to remove a tree on the spot as much as possible at once, rather than come back and forth and do little pieces at a time. It's a matter of efficiency for our Parks Department.
So you don't feel that it could be coordinated with a private contractor, a local contractor? In other words, say to them, we're going to be removing the following trees. Could you have a log hauling truck respond to that location?
I think it could be problematic because we'd have to bid it out with a low bidder, mm-hmm. get award. And a low bidder may have a better offer, particularly if we have a severe storm event. As many residents know, pricing for tree work on the private market often gets more expensive during a storm event when there's a greater demand for the service. We have, and the village did this year, contract for removals to catch up on our backlog, and that contractor didn't remove trees, stalks in one operation. So yes, it has been done, but that was a full bid with trees at specific addresses.
Okay. Thank you. under the information systems, again, seems like we're buying phone systems and computers and servers every few months. And again, in the, I guess this is another one of those things that, Heather, you were pointing out, that we went to bonded in December of 2012, $24,000 for computer upgrades, and now we bonded another $33,000.
We continually replace computers as they get old, as they get broken, as they get slow. It's on a rotational basis throughout all the village departments. I would say probably computers are replaced maybe every 4 to 5 years. It's not, mm-hmm. it's, you know, throughout the village. Mm-hmm. You know, people will have them for up to 4 or 5 years each, which actually for a computer is pretty old. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they slow down with age, and especially if they have a lot of files on them. Mm-hmm. Also, with the particular one for the phone here under information systems is for an upgrade of the voicemail. The voicemail we got, I think it was 7 to 8 years ago. And so it's most likely, you know, going to go sometime soon. And so we're trying to be proactive instead of reactive and trying to upgrade the voicemail system.
Okay. And could you perhaps answer what this installation of a security system is? What is that?
We've already begun it, actually. It's swipe cards for various departments, such as the municipal court, our mailroom, I know the coin room. So only certain employees will have access to those areas, and this will allow more security throughout the building.
Okay, thank you. At the bottom under engineering street resurfacing, this is where I think that we are underfunding it. I really think that we need to increase our resources to street resurfacing and protect the infrastructure. I think there are a lot of streets in this village that need to be resurfaced. I don't mean patching them, I mean resurfacing them. And $1 million, I don't believe, is enough money for that. It's very expensive, of course, to resurface streets, but we're falling further behind. So I would urge the council to consider a better, more money for street resurfacing. I think that's money well spent long term. Also under streets, I would like to know, we're spending, we bonded $10,000 in 2012 and now $94,000 for a facilities master plan update and improvements. What is a facilities master plan? I don't understand what that is. It's a lot of money, so someone maybe could explain that.
Go ahead.
Facilities master plan that's already been initially funded is to conduct an examination of how the village operates, how our facilities work. We have a number of facilities spread throughout the village and also in Glen Rock, the water pollution plant, as you well know. And the goal here is to find out how can we optimize the return for the residents from those facilities. Current that's being discussed is what the Deputy Mayor mentioned with the potential study for the relocation of fleet services to the water pollution plant. That is being funded out of the initial $10,000. The goal there is to see, is that idea viable? What benefits it brings us also brings possible benefits with partnering with Glen Rock. Roger, you know yourself quite well. We have a number of facilities that are starting to show their age.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. But why is it so expensive? This is $10,000 plus $94,000 is $104,000. I mean, are we hiring engineers or what do we would, architects or what do we do?
It would be a comprehensive RFP if we went for the full amount, and it would require the services of architects, engineers, and planners to look where our facilities would suit the village best. The village is very much constrained by the availability of open space or land. Where can we put things? What can we do? Are there ideas that we have not pursued in terms of joint ventures, such as the one we're considering right now down at water pollution with Glen Rock? That may be a direction to go. We'd have to find out.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
And I just have two other questions, and I'll be done. Under the water pollution control plant, we funded the acquisition of a sludge truck in 2012 with the December with that previous capital ordinance, and now we have another request for funding of a sludge hauling tank truck. So, do we have two sludge trucks? Is that what we have?
No, what we did initially start a sinking fund, as Heather explained, where we try to put away a little bit over a number of years so that we have the amount budgeted for when the piece of equipment needs to be replaced. At water pollution, we're looking at replacing our sludge hauling truck that takes the sludge from our digesters and brings it to the end disposal place in Lincoln Park. We are also looking at replacing our sewer line cleaning truck, the jet truck, that is also getting up in its years. It's having a number of breakdowns, and that piece of equipment he's used to keep the collection system open and flowing as best as possible.
No, I have no complaints with that. I just wondered with the sludge truck what we were doing with that. Now, again, Chris, if you mind, just for us guys that don't know, would it be possible, I mean, do we need that truck, or could we sub this out to a company that would come and pick it up?
Yes, you could probably sub it out, but that, again, could leave us to the mercies of a vendor. When the digesters are full, they need to be emptied, the sludge decanted, then hauled. We haul 5 days a week, Monday through Friday, anywhere from 1 to 2 loads a day. We also use that very truck in the plant to transfer material from some of the grease pits into the head end of the plant, because it has a vacuum suction feature on it, and that's very helpful in maintaining the plant. So okay. The truck is just not merely for transport. We've also used the truck because of its suction feature on sewer main breaks, so that if we have a broken sewer main and an excavation is filling up with effluent, we have the ability to remove the effluent without causing it to be run into a storm sewer, which is a DEP prohibited action.
Okay, thank you. And the last question I have, and I think Mr. Sanzari may know the answer to this one. Under the sanitation and recycling, I see we're bonding to buy 2 more Packer trucks. And under the December 2012 capital ordinance, we bought 3 trucks. So by my count, we should have 5 new Packer trucks on the road. But I do not see new Packer trucks operating. I see other Packer trucks that look like they probably should have been retired 5 years ago. So what's going on here? Are we actually going to buy these trucks? I mean, or why is there a delay in purchasing or getting these trucks into service?
We just bought 3. We actually just authorized 3. And it takes a while to get them once the contracts are out. So, and you're right, our fleet for our Packer trucks is deteriorating. And so this will allow for an additional 2, one for recycling and 1 for sanitation. So, yes, we will have 5 new eventually, but it does take a while from the time of the order to the time of receiving it.
Okay, good. Thank you. Yes, because this is needed. There's no doubt about that. Okay, that's... thank you for your patience, and appreciate it, and hopefully we'll get some of this stuff into service before long.
Great. Thanks, Roger. Thanks for your good questions. Appreciate it. Any other questions or comments? All right. I got to find where I am. Move the public hearing be closed.
Second.
Hauck.
Yes.
Pucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes.
I move that ordinance 3392 be adopted on second reading and final publication as required by law.
Second.
Hauck.
Yes.
Pucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. I move the clerk read ordinance 3393 by title on second reading and that the public hearing thereon be opened.
Second.
Hauck.
Yes.
Pucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. Will the clerk please read the title of ordinance 3393?
A bond ordinance providing for various water utility improvements in and by the Village of Ridgewood in the County of Bergen, New Jersey, appropriating $2,126,250 therefor, and authorizing the issuance of $2,019,000 bonds or notes of the Village to finance part of the cost thereof.
The public hearing is now open. Any questions, comments? All right, I move the public hearing be closed.
Second.
Hauck.
Yes.
Pucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes.
I move that ordinance 3393 be adopted on the second reading and the final publication as required by law.
Second.
Hauck.
Yes.
Pucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. I move the clerk read ordinance 3394 by title on second reading and the public hearing thereon be opened.
Second.
Hauck.
Yes.
Pucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. Will the clerk please read the title of ordinance 3394?
A bond ordinance providing for various parking utility improvements in and by the Village of Ridgewood in the County of Bergen, New Jersey, appropriating $368,560 therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $350,000 bonds or notes of the Village to finance part of the cost thereof.
Public hearing is now open. I move the public hearing to now be closed.
Second.
Houck.
Yes.
Pucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes.
I have a motion.
I move the public hearing be closed.
We need a motion.
The ordinance 3394 be adopted on second reading and final publication as required by law.
Second.
Houck.
Yes.
Pucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. I move the clerk read ordinance 3388.
Just before we go on, I just want to comment on the bond ordinances in light of the questions that were raised. And it won't be long, but it's somewhat repetitious of what was said at the last meeting, and I think it is helpful. First of all, I learned that a bond ordinance is not approval for a specific expenditure. So the item will come back. Every specific item has to come back to the council. Second, the true cost of our operations is not accurately reflected when you have, say, a $308,000 log hauling truck with a 5-year useful life. You're burning up that truck at $60,000 a year. Under government accounting principles, that $60,000 is not reflected in the operating budget. One of the comments of the Financial Advisory Committee is that we reflect depreciation the way it's done in private business. And third, I recognize, at least for me, the process for the capital budget was not nearly as rigorous as it was for the operating budget. I'm not sure why that gap exists between the level of scrutiny that we give to the operating budget and the scrutiny we give to the capital budget. So a point that Roger made is well taken. We really need to have the department heads, when they present the operating budget, present the capital budget at the same time. So the kind of questioning we heard tonight would take place. So the process this year really is one that, at least for me, I'm relying very heavily upon our staff and our village manager to have done the work that I think this council is obligated to do. And going forward, next go around, we will, I'm sure, take a more rigorous look at the capital budget. It's a lot of money. And it really is not separate from the operating budget, because capital expenditures are, to the extent they're depreciating, reflected in your operating budget. So we need to view them as really very much one and the same. So anyway, going forward, I hope we will do that. Thank you.
Good. Thank you. Good points. Now, continued public hearing of 3388. I move the clerk read ordinance 3388 by title on fourth reading.
Second.
Houck.
Yes.
Pucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. Will the clerk please read the title of ordinance 3388?
An ordinance to amend Chapter 145 of the Code of the Village of Ridgewood Fees at Section 145-6, enumeration of fees relating to code chapters.
The public hearing on ordinance 3388 was continued from last month's public meeting so that a meeting could be set up at the Chamber of Commerce to discuss this ordinance further. This meeting has now taken place, and an agreement has been reached by the Village and the Chamber of Commerce that the sewer fees will not increase this year, but there will be further discussion of what will be done going forward concerning these fees. Ordinance 3388 will be defeated this evening. However, the public hearing on this ordinance was advertised for this evening, so it will be held at this time. The public hearing is now continued. Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Boyd Loving, 342 South Irving Street. Happy to see that Mr. Sanzari is in the room this evening, because my question is one that I believe will be answered by him. And that is, were the anticipated revenues from the increase in sewer fees budgeted in 2012, 2013? In other words, were you counting on these revenues? Were they included in the budget?
No. In the 2013 budget, you're only allowed to anticipate the actual cash that you received in the prior year.
So we weren't counting on getting this revenue?
No.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you. Any other comments, questions?
We actually have to move the public hearing be closed. That was omitted from your script. So we do need a motion for that.
I move the public hearing be closed.
Second.
Houck.
Yes.
Cucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes.
I move that ordinance 3388 be defeated.
I second.
And a yes vote is to defeat. Houck.
Yes.
Cucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes.
The following resolutions, number 13-241 through 13-253, will be adopted on consent agenda with one vote by the Village Council. They will be read by title only. Appoint Clean Communities Coordinator. Appoint Joint Insurance Fund Commissioner. Title 59 approval, furnishing and delivering sodium hypochlorite solution for the Water Department. Award extension of contract, furnishing and delivering sodium hypochlorite solution, April to December 2013, for the Water Department. Title 59 approval, cold water meters. Award contract, cold water meters. Award contract under county contract, bituminous concrete, sand, and stone materials. Award contract under county contract, rock salt. Approve light path access to cell site, water pollution control facility. Authorize payment of mail retention and coinsurance reimbursement payment. Confirm endorsement of community development block grant, family promise of Bergen County, family shelter support services. Award professional services contract, tasks 1 and 2, proposed municipal garage. Approved change order security system installation. May I have a motion?
Move the consent.
Second.
Houck.
Yes.
Cucciarelli.
Yes.
Ritchie.
Yes.
Walsh.
Yes.
And Aronson.
Yes. I'll take comments from the public.
Good evening again. Boyd Loving, 342 South Irving Street. I'd like to make a few comments about the proposed garage in Glenrock. First of all, I'm somewhat uncomfortable, particularly with respect to the situation that Glenrock was supposed to have approved something, and it's 7 minutes after nine, and we don't know whether they have approved it tonight or not. Realize that this is a small amount of money, but we're moving forward with a project that ultimately will cost a pretty penny. And I'm just wondering what our game plan is with respect to how deeply are we going to get into this with Glenrock before a decision is made in terms of what's going to be the final picture on this. What percentage of the cost are the taxpayers of Ridgewood going to be paying versus the percentage of the cost that the taxpayers of Glenrock are going to be paying? And when are we going to make that decision? How much money are the taxpayers of Ridgewood going to fork over before the decision is made in terms of what's the big picture on this? That's, and if you could just hold off for a second, Mr. Cucciarelli, I have some other comments. So that's my first concern. Are we going to wind up paying 50-50 for this when it's all over? 90-10, 70-30? And how are those percentages going to be ultimately determined? And how far are we going to get into this before that decision is made? My other comments concern the proposed location for this. The proposed location. Mr. Deputy Mayor, you've gone on record indicating that the existing facility, which is located on Chestnut Street, one of the reasons that we would like to move it is that it is in a residential neighborhood. The facility that you're proposing is also in what I consider to be a residential neighborhood. I don't know what that area is zoned in Glenrock is, but it is, with the exception of the water pollution control plant and the house of worship next door, that area is occupied now by single-family homes. So I'm a bit unclear as to why we're moving it from one residential neighborhood to another residential neighborhood. I'm particularly concerned because I live on a through street that provides access to that location. Right now, I look out of my window at various times of the day, and I see trucks from the signal department going up and down my street, trucks from water pollution control going up down my street, and trucks from the street department going up and down my street. And I know that they're not conducting business on the street. They're using that street as a cut-through in order to get to Prospect Street. So not only am I concerned about the people in my own neighborhood, those who live on Prospect Street will also be affected. Those who live on Grove Street will be affected. Pleasant Avenue, Van Deen, all those routes will now carry traffic with trucks headed to and from this proposed facility. So again, one residential neighborhood to another residential neighborhood, does it make sense? So if you could just comment at some point in time about the cost factor in terms of how it will be determined, how much skin we're going to have in the game versus Glen Rock, and the idea of locating this in another residential area. Thank you.
Thank you. I would like to comment on, first of all, the game plan and the cost-sharing elements. We have a pretty good precedent so far in sharing 50-50. Glen Rock has agreed to share 50% of this cost. I recognize that's not a commitment to spend 50% to share 50-50 going forward, but let's take a step at a time. This is where we want it to be at this point in time, sharing the cost 50-50. I said at the last meeting that you can't really estimate the cost for the new facility and even the program for the new facility until you find a site, there's a potential site. The project is going to be very site specific. If you build the same kind of facility somewhere else, the configuration and therefore the cost is going to be very different. You have to start somewhere. And looking at that site seemed like a pretty good candidate as to where this might be, recognizing it's not perfect and there may be objections to it. And those objections may prevail and we may decide we don't want to proceed there. My impression now is that that's a pretty good site for it, based on what I've seen. I've walked the site several times and it looks like it may work. On the question of the present facility being in a residential zone, I stress the idea that the present facility is inadequate. Before I even got to the issue of where it's located, we had testimony from the individual who manages it, and plus all of us had a tour of that facility. And I remember when we approved the expenditure of $70,000 more into that facility, thinking the expenditures into that facility are never going to stop. The expenditures for a village garage are out there. Where are we going to put the money? We're going to put them into maintaining that facility, which is inherently inadequate. The lot is too narrow and there's lots of problems with that particular facility. Or are we going to start thinking about putting our resources in a state-of-the-art facility? I was concerned that it was near the central business district, and I said it also abuts a residential district. My chief concern was that if you walk Chestnut Street from Franklin up to where our garage is, it's sort of renovation or improvement waiting to happen. It's a street that's on the cusp of a better day. If you look at the project proposed by the Bolger Company, the planning board is looking at that. Something will be built on that site, which hopefully will improve that street. If you look at we have a Ken Smith site that is at the beginning of the street at the south end that's vacant. Something is going to be built there that hopefully will improve that street. The street is probably going to improve from south to north. There are residences just to the north of our garage, and it strikes me as bad planning for the town to be the single biggest obstacle in the redevelopment, in the renovation or the reinvigoration of that street. Right now, it's just tottering. Is it going to remain a place for tow trucks and garbage trucks being repaired out in the street with the totally out-of-place dance studio across the street? Or in our planning vision, do we have a better vision for that street? I have a better vision for it. So I think it's a worthy discussion for this council to have as to whether that facility should be replaced. And in my mind, there's no doubt it should be replaced. And therefore, it gets us to the question of where would the new facility be? If you've got a better site to propose, let's hear it. But Glen Rock is in favor of that site as a place where they will share the cost for us. Hopefully 50-50, but we'll see going forward.
If I could just add to it, just sort of stepping back, this is potentially one of the more exciting, more promising things that we've undertaken. And I want to commend the deputy mayor and the folks that are on our side who have been involved, as well as Mayor Van Kuren, for really looking at this, for taking a step back. You know, we always talk about government having to sort of think differently and act differently, trying this idea, concept of the new normal. And we talk about shared services and why do we always have to do everything ourselves. Well, here's an opportunity, potentially, for sharing a service, and you're right to bring up, you know, the potential cost to Ridgewood taxpayers. We think about that all the time, but what we're hoping for is finding some savings, some efficiencies, and making it not just more efficient but more effective. So where this process takes us, it's hard to say. We're taking it step by step, but again, the folks involved, the deputy mayor particularly, you know, have been approaching this very thoughtfully, very carefully. and it's a step-by-step process. And this initiative we're undertaking here, the study, is just the latest step in that process. Again, it may not lead us to where we want it to, but it may, and it's definitely worth taking a chance. So, thanks. Any other comments, questions? All right, resolution to go into closed session, please.
Be resolved by the Village Council of the Village of Ridgewood that the Village Council meet in closed session on October 9th, 2013 at 8 p.m. or soon thereafter as the matter on the agenda can be reached. And the said closed session be held in the caucus room on the fourth floor of the Ridgewood Village Hall, 131 North Maple Avenue, Ridgewood, New Jersey. And be further resolved that the matters to be discussed in closed session are limited to contract negotiations to include donation from Bolger Foundation and personnel matters to include police department. These matters are allowable under NJSA 10:4-12 et sec. And be it further resolved that the minutes of this meeting shall be made available to the general public when such matters have been deemed completed by resolution of the Village Council. May I have a motion?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you.
All right. Thank you, everybody. Appreciate it.
Wish I had another soda. Heather, why don't you buy sodas instead of water?
We used to have some.